26 talking on street photography. So we really have quite a lineup. I encourage you to check the website, consider joining up with us. And we'll get started tonight now with Peter Hewitt. Peter is a friend of mine that I met through, some of you know, Henry Rowan's Pennsylvania Center for Photography, one of his workshops. Peter is a very skilled professional photographer after a scientific career. He's also a professional fine art printer and framer. Peter's out in Doylestown. He's going to be talking to us tonight about your creative potential in looking at landscapes, and I'll let Peter introduce his topic now. And at this point, I'll have Peter, you can screen share.
Okay.
I'll ask the audience to mute their mics and then pop their questions into the chat room, which I'll monitor and pass the questions on to Peter. So welcome aboard, Peter.
Thanks. Can you see the first slide?
We can. Learning how
to. Oh, excellent. And it fits?
It does. Looks great.
Wow. I tell you, those people at Zoom, they know what they're doing.
Indeed.
So there we go. So what I'm going to,
You all right?
There we go. I will be in a second. I was just having a hard time seeing part of my screen there because of the gallery view, and just closing that down. I think if I could just hide the that's it. Hide the video panel. That's easier for me now. So, well, thank you very much, Vince, for the invitation. And it's really an honor to be able to speak with you guys. I attended your last meeting, and really interesting group. I'm looking forward to chatting with you on this topic here. And as an intro from a little bit more than what Vince had said, you know, who I am. I worked as a molecular diagnostic development scientist for 30 years across five different large companies for diagnostic products, HIV viral load, tuberculosis, sexually transmitted disease, several different types of cancers. And I even spent 5 years working on developing rapid DNA sequencing technology. So in my last job, I turned 55, and they started downsizing. And I was amazed at how hard it was to find work again. And my wife said, well, what would you really like to do? And I said, I think I want to become an artist. And she looked at me and she said, what do you know about art? And I said, nothing, absolutely nothing. And that was 11 years ago. And at this time now, I've been 10 years ago, I figured out how to make pictures, and I started selling limited edition prints at fine art shows and exhibitions. Now, these were shows that they were outdoor shows for the most part. You had to jury into them. I was pretty good at writing these things, and I could put together a booth picture, and that they were expensive. They were like $500 to $800 a show, and there was a lot of competition. And I chose that as my way to get into it because I couldn't see myself going to art school for a bunch of years and then coming out. I said, you know what? I know enough about business. I can start this. I like photography. I'll figure it out. The other thing that I figured out was how to print. And after a while, I was able to rapidly turn my images into prints. And it was Henry Rowan who actually suggested to me about 3-4 years ago, after he asked me to do his printing for him because his printer broke. And he said, have you ever considered offering your services? And 3 years ago I did. And it was amazing how that took off thanks to the support of Henry, who had started saying that I was the only printer that he used for anybody, for anything of his. I've lived in Doylestown for the last 30 years with my wife. We've been together for 36, have two children, 30 and 33 years of age, a girl and a boy. I also do a lot of giving back, conservation. I like to do the national parks. Nature's Conservancy is great. They really, you know, you can count on almost 80% of your money really going to the conservancy. We also started 5 or 6 years ago our own Haiti medical mission team, and we're actually a fully approved 501c3. And I've been involved with quite a bit in the Pinelands the last 3 years. I'm on the their steering committee for their annual photographic exhibition show, and I'm involved in the jurying, and I run the entire smarter entry for the PPA. So I've gotten pretty good, you know, with that. So I like technology. So photography, what, you know, why do I like doing this so much? I've always been an outdoor person, and I connect a lot to the landscape and being out with nature. And I just absolutely love exploring with my camera. The way I've approached photography is, you know, after looking at many ways to do this, I like to go out with the freedom of setting no preconceived notions of what sort of photos I'm going to make or not. The fun really starts for me when something catches my eye, and that's how I go. I basically look at my the weather map, apps on my phone, Gaia topological maps, and I know how to, you know, what interesting terrain there'll be, what time of day it is, and I'm pretty good at reading the weather maps enough to know and where the sun is, of where I'm likely to find interesting moods and atmosphere. And when I'm out there, I actually have learned how to do composition because I've adopted a lot of the skills that painters have been doing for a couple of hundred years and written lots of books about. I love printing. My favorite quote on printing is John Sexton, and it's so true. It's the magic that can be exciting, disappointing, rewarding, and frustrating all in the same few minutes. It's kind of like trying to go out with a camera and explore and make the perfect image. It's a great combination. I'm a scientist. I love studying these things and solving those kinds of problems. And, you know, it feeds my creative soul and it makes me happy. Since this is a camera club, I felt I should just put it out there what my camera bag and toolbox is. I switched to a mirrorless camera for the first time ever. I went down the path of the R5 from Canon. I just have a 5 lenses, you know, the typical zooms that you'd expect, macro. I think I own just about everything that Really Right Stuff might have for tripods and ball heads. They make such great gear. I love it. It holds up to the worst conditions, and it just, you know, it's reliable, and I love it. I also like the breakthrough technology filters that they put out in the last 2 years. Especially the circular polarizer. I use an iMac 27 computer. This year, I'd had another problem with hard disks. I have a lot of data that I have, and I've gone to a RAID 5 tower. Promise Technology has something that it's 24 terabytes, 20 of it across 6 drives. I'm pretty safe, and I still have backup drives that I use for backing up that. I do my own calibrations all the time with the X-Rite i1 Display Pro. I have a really nice printer. For software, I pretty much use just Lightroom and Photoshop. Once in a while, I might have something, if I have a noisy image, I might run it through DxO, and there, once in a while, there's a special effect or something that I might want to try from DxO as a last step in processing. And I just love luminosity masks that you can get. I prefer Lumensia. I found it very intuitive to use. Never had to read the manual, just knew how to use it right from the first time I downloaded it. And I have a lot of apps on my mobile phone, as I'd mentioned before, that I use to help put me out in the field. An overview of how I broke the presentation down for tonight is how I got past just making lucky photos. Then I wanted to go into visual perception versus reality, the nature of seeing and designing images, adding impact to images, and photographers that inspired me. I wanted to call out some names of people. So in the first of how I got past just making lucky photos, 11 years ago, and before that, I would go out with family, we'd go on a vacation, and by about 2009, the family said, please don't take the camera along. you won't be with us. You're just going to abandon us, and your photos are terrible. And every time I'd get one that I thought I knew what I was doing, that's my lucky 1 out of 1,000. And there I'd go, and I never really understood how I did that. It really was my lucky photo. I never could reproduce a picture like that again. So being a scientist and wanting to get better at this, I started to do more reading and talking to other photographers and doing workshops that were devoted to photography. And I started to appreciate how eyes and cameras see so differently. I also started to learn that creativity can be learned and why thinking like an artist is really important. A lot of photography, when you first start getting into it, as you all know, is that it's about the gear. And when I went on my vacations, I would look forward to that as an opportunity now that I know how to do photography, I'm going to buy an even better camera for this vacation. So I had a lot of stuff that was piling up, and they got to know me way too well at Adorama for doing trade-ins, but I enjoyed it, and but I don't churn gear anymore. Last time I bought a camera was 5 years ago, and that was it. I also understand why and how I wanted to make images, which I described to you on the second slide, and started to set goals and create projects for myself so that I could challenge things and put different kinds of filters on what I do to go out there so that I can, those limits really help you to grow, and that you don't, you think more about how to approach things and make things possible. So this image, this was taken 10 years ago. I tried to go back to the earliest picture in my Lightroom catalog, and this was it. I actually knew exactly how I wanted to approach this image. It was out in Wyoming at the Oxbow Bend, and I had my really right stuff, tripod, I had it all leveled, I knew what a nodal point was. And after about 9 images, I had enough content that I could then start approaching how to make a panoramic. And I must say, I think it took me 4 weeks to optimize this so that it looked like this. It wasn't crooked. The light was all right. And I was really happy with it. I can't show you the before of this because I had a hard drive crash last fall, and I ended up deleting all of the original raw pictures that I'd had that went into this, because I said, what do I need those for? I have this. So, but here's an illustration of what thinking like an artist means to me. When I go into a scene these days, I don't really just see the subject matter of mountains or the trees or the rocks on anything that I do for the kind of abstracts that I like to make. And I generally don't do scenes that are as iconic and location like this. When I was here, there were easily 60 other photographers doing the same sunrise at this location. But the way I look at a scene like this now, when I go into it as an artist, I see things as shapes, objects, lines, patterns, textures, brightness, contrast. And I start looking at this and I figure out what's the right way to creatively make an exposure so that I will have the most information possible, that I'll be able to turn this into a print. And when I was there, the yellow arrows, lines are really important of directing viewers' attention. And if you start at the bottom, you can see the arrows starting to go around. And it's like this serpentine flow. It's like a river, you know, just go following it along. And, you know, I start down low, I go up to the middle, I go up a little bit, cut back across to the right. And then you can go all the way across and you can come down the other mountain and you can go right back to where I started. The triangles are things that I knew I wanted to have in the picture. I knew that they'd be strong objects, and I was lucky there was symmetry in this too, which is visually interesting. And triangles are very important design elements when you're trying to put together a composition that's going to be interesting for the eye to explore. The red arrow that I have going up, I realized at the time when I was making this, it's all about the light in photography, and your eye's going to go to the brightest thing. And what I really did here was to try and help create a sense of depth in this. Creating the line like I did, there's one thing that can start to give you depth. And the things, and you can see too, sharpness, you know, as you get in contrast, it gets a little bit duller by the time you go from the front to the mountain range. And those are what I call visual cues that let the viewer get a sense of going from what's in your mind's eye to two dimensional, he had a good camera. I wish I had a camera like that. The red arrow that I was talking about, what that was doing was going from dark to bright. And essentially, when I was exposing it, there's a gradient from dark to bright. And that was, you know, 10 years ago. I've gotten much more sophisticated now on how I use gradients and radial masks and graduated gradients with all kinds of cool things that you can do to add contrast and color and very selectively make edits. So that was a little good lead in to visual perception versus reality. And I think all of us, before we start picking up a camera and trying to make an image that we think is going to be interesting to viewers, we all know what good, you know, what's appealing to us. We just know, you feel it immediately, you can tell instinctively, and the mind is naturally drawn to structure and good compositions. If something is out of balance and does not fit well, you just know. If you haven't studied art, you might not have the language in order to describe what those things are, that you could maybe get some advice from somebody or make an improvement. So I think people should have a lot more confidence of trusting their judgment on what they see as an interesting design out there. But I think to really take it to the next level, there are certain things that you can learn about from a 3D visualization to a 2D reality. And I refer to these as the visual cues that add depth and feeling to your images. And I'm very conscious of those things right from the start. I know when I'm in the field, whether it's going to be a black and white or a color image, and I always expose for what the most important object that I see or design in there. And I actually, on my camera, I separate light metering from focusing so that there are two different events. I've had two different buttons. The new camera that I have, everything can be one button, and there are some really clever things that it does, but I'm still getting used to it. So the nature of seeing certain things over others, whether you've studied it or not, we all know that the human figure, face, eyes are very, very powerful things that people, when they see an image, they're going to see those things first. Large objects before small ones, light tones and dark areas, contrast and elements that are sharp and in focus. Those are very important tools that I use to create depth and to draw the eye into. Elements that are recognizable, that we're familiar with, those will jump out to people. Diagonal lines are very powerful in an image. You can add diagonal elements and it creates an energy. You can see the curving line that I had in the first picture that I put up there, that was intentionally done diagonally to create an artificial energy and something that would, you know, make the eye curious to follow. There are all kinds of little things that I do where I'll put very, very slight amounts of sharpness along those lines. You really won't find traces of anything in my images of where I've been editing. Things like elements that are warm before cool will jump out at people, and elements of emotional significance jump out. So those are just some examples of what we are attracted to that, unless you've had training, you might not really think about it. And certainly if you're trying to take your photography to a next level, through trial and error, you're going to figure this out on your own. Of a picture that I took that is an abstract, and this is kind of the format that I'm going to use for all the rest of the images that I have for this presentation. The left side here is the raw image that I had for my camera. And you can see it looks flat. There's no contrast or anything. And I do that intentionally. I shoot neutral on my camera because for the editing process that I've chosen for myself, I like to shoot from a neutral place so that my starting point is most familiar to me with whatever image that I'm working on. So you can see the histogram that I have down below, I've made sure when I made that image that I have lots of room on the left and the right of what I thought the strongest components of this composition were, and that I've left myself lots of room when I start editing to go to the left or right on anything. If you shoot something and it's too broad, it's real easy if you start making contrast adjustments, you're going to put yourself out of gamut pretty quickly. And even though it might look nice on the computer screen, when you try to take it to the print, it's not as predictable as an image that is in gamut. And it makes it extremely laborious to try and make corrections that are just going to have to be by empirical testing. If you stay in gamut, and the image on the right, that's pretty close. That is the final image at the time, about 12 years ago, that I made. And you can see everything was in gamut, and I was really happy with this.
Excuse me, Peter.
Yes.
Could I ask you to go back?
Sure. To this page?
Yes.
Okay.
Can you explain what you mean by in gamut, but back a little bit further as well?
Sure.
You shoot to the neutral point.
Yeah. So when you,
can you explain that also?
Yeah. When you have a camera, it's always a JPEG that gets viewed on the LCD on the back. But if you go into picture styles, you can choose something that might say bold, it might say landscape, it might say people, it might say nighttime. And what the camera does is it actually has these algorithms that the camera manufacturer, every camera manufacturer has to make their own algorithms, because all of their software that they use, the firmware, it's proprietary to their devices. So what I do, and when the pictures look nice on the back of a JPEG, that algorithm, if you choose a landscape one, it's likely to give you something that might look like what I have on the right. But, you know, if I started with that, the histogram is going to be in that direction. And I don't know if I'm shooting in RAW, which I always do, I need to know what's on the sensor. I don't really care what's on the JPEG, because when I see the histogram, I know where all the light is in that image, and I'm in control of that image. Gamut, if you notice on the top of the rectangles here, there's something like a black heart shape there. If you were to make an exposure that it was like too far to the right and it was getting to be too bright, that would start to turn colors on you. It would start to get white, and it would show you that you're in excess of what your sensor can capture. And the reason why that's important is because, and the same is true for the other side of this histogram, if you go out of gamut, you are now outside of the way the people designed ICC profiles, which is where color management occurs between all devices, whether it's your iPhone, your computer, your camera. And there are algorithms, there are all kinds of algorithms that are out there that basically try to simulate what should look normal to the eye. And back in the 1930s, people actually did true data testing where they had over 30,000 people that they interviewed, and they showed them all these colors, and they'd ask them these series of questions, and they cataloged it. And what they did is that they mathematically described color so that you could now make profiles for whatever device you want. It was mostly about TVs, you know, digital cameras like we have now didn't exist then. But, you know, if you wanted to view something, this is what you needed to have and do. And between this, you know, by the time digital occurred, it really wasn't until about the 1980s that the International Consortium for Color Management had gotten together, and they'd agreed on standards of how to define color and what color management for devices would be. And so that's basically the long backstory of why, you know, if you go out of gamut, you're out of the linear range of how managing color on your visual display devices and your capture device, the camera, are going to record them. And if you go out of the linear range, what's going to happen to you is that you'll never know. You could have things that, you know, they might look fine. They'll be, you can make it go into gamut, but you can't predict how the print is going to be. This profile here, I can predict these papers, and I have enough experience, and I refer to it as tone mapping of what an image looks like on my computer screen. And what happens when you go from transmitted light on your computer screen to reflected light off of a piece of paper from a printer, it can get ugly really fast. And I have some other things that I'd like to show you from a page that I have towards the end of the talk that are food for thought on what else to be thinking about, how to stay within those linear ranges and be in control of your editing and, you know, achieving the kind of images that you really envision for yourself. Is that a good answer for you, Vince?
Yes, Peter, that was. Thank you.
So for this image, here's what I saw as an artist going in. This was a very, very busy composition. And the first things that I saw were human faces. You know, what I have in the circles, in the white, I saw these faces. And I saw a Picasso Cubist painting in this seawall of a tide that had just come down up in Acadia that only comes around every 3 or 4 hours that you can see this when the tide goes down low enough so you can walk out to an island. So the white circles, those were figures that were human. And I said, well, how can I connect all these things and make it interesting as a picture and not be too busy? So what I did on the, I looked around and I found that one stone in there that I refer to as a keystone. And I said, oh, look at that. I have all of these things that radiate around that stone. And you can see on the yellow arrows, they're all cracks that I find very powerful visual cues that the eye will naturally, when they see that, they're gonna go back and forth. They're gonna look down that crack, that line, and they're gonna explore it, and they're gonna go back up, and they go in a circle or something, you know, they'll probably go to the next crack up, and they'll go back and forth, and they'll just do that all the way around. And I know people do that because one of the biggest compliments that I get when people see my prints when they're on exhibition, and I have large 20 by 30 inch printed frames of these, they'll say, I don't know what it is about this picture. I don't know what it is, but I can't stop looking at it. And I know I've done the right thing because those are all the visual cues that I look for to make an image interesting so that people won't get tired of looking at it. If somebody buys some of my art, you know, I don't want them to just look at it and then, you know, in 6 months or 12 months get tired of it and start looking for something else. I try to design them so that they're going to last a really long time, and it's likely that you'll always find some kind of pleasure for it each time you go at it. I know I do with this one. Probably the most interesting thing that I did, which was hard in trying to optimize this image, was it was so busy, the edges were just too distracting. And I'll show you what I mean. I'll go back to the original one. If you look to the picture on the left, which is the raw image, it was so busy around the image. But if you look to the one on the right, what I did was I found if I added a dark vignette to it, it just made it dark and it wasn't as interesting, and I wanted something to brighten it up. And what I found was I added a negative vignette, and that negative vignette, it simplified the image enough that you might not notice that I did something to this or care, but it took care of all the detail around there. I didn't have to go around and unsharpen things. It was just a vignette, and it was a really simple, quick fix to it. And that's what I mean. You know, when I optimize images, I can't do it in one sitting. I might spend 15, you know, to 30 minutes on it one day, and then I just let it rest. And then I come back to it, and it's a process, and it might take me 3 or 4 times until my memory of the image, your mind has all kinds of things that it remembers things, you know, there are latent things, and I'll discuss it later, of what you have to look out for. So that's why it's important to sometimes just walk away from it. I came back to this image recently, and I went, you know, what could I do to take a fresh look at this again? And I took it from, instead of 2-to-3 aspect ratio, I took it to a 1-to-1 aspect ratio, and I just, I compressed it, the whole image as before. And I touched up some of the colors, and, you know, I'm still, you know, thinking about this, and I don't know whether I like it or not, but I did something different. And that's what I do with the images. Even though when I make images, I make them as limited editions, the large ones. I just make 10 copies of it, and then I retire the image. When I do something like this to it, or I put out a new version of it, I still keep the edition limit, you know, the same. It gets added to that edition of 10, and then I'm done with it. And I feel as though the artist, you know, if you want to change the image in that much, you know, you can do that. But I have to be honest to my, you know, the people that have purchased my art. When I say limit of 10, I mean it. I didn't promise it's always going to be the same, but I will promise you there will not be another copy of that around.
Peter, by just to clarify, negative vignette means that you've lightened
it. I lightened it instead of darkened it. So all I did was I moved the slider to make it bright rather than darken it. Usually people, when they do vignettes, they'll do it as a last thing to try and make the, you know, whatever is in the center of something, or if you start to get a little more selective in your editing, you might try radial filters, and you can shape them in anything you want. You can make them as ovals, you know, big circles, lopsided circles. You can add multiple ones, and you can do all kinds of things to add drama to pictures now that you couldn't a few years ago. And it's unbelievable how powerful they can be. And I'll share with you of how you can do all these kinds of things with just 3 different adjustment layers in Photoshop and with 3 different types of controls. You don't have to go off the deep end for making creative pictures. And that's something that I haven't really appreciated as much until just the last 2 or 3 years.
And it looks like the next one has no vignette.
Yeah, that has no vignette at all. Yeah, it's just straight out. And I darkened it a lot. You can see where the lines are. It's not something that I could get tired of that, or it doesn't draw me in is like, you know, this one does entirely, but I find it interesting. So I'll sit on it. It's going to incubate some more, and I'll be curious to see what I might do with it next week or next year. I don't work to any particular timeline on these images. I do all the art for myself. And that's where I find that's very important to do. If you try and, you know, if you want to go into selling art, I went into selling art. I didn't go into galleries because I found the 40 to 60% commissions really offensive, but I really wanted to challenge myself and put myself out there to find audiences and see their reactions to my art. And I paid very close attention to the feedback that people would give me at the different art shows. And some of the art shows I went to, you know, I'd been in one at Lincoln Center many times. I'd been to the Madison Museum of Contemporary Art. They have a Art on the Square, they call it. They'll have 150,000 to 175,000 people that'll come by in a 2-day period. They have over 200 artists. It's a hard show to get into, and I've been at it 3 times. Very lucky to get into it, and I've done well at that show. I've been at the Ann Arbor art show. That's like a 4 or 5 day event. They'll get 500,000 people over a 4 or 5 day period. Try getting into that show. The jurying is, it's wicked. I think the show that was most interesting for me, I got into the what's been the number one or two art show in the country. It's in a little bedroom community in Belleville, Illinois, bedroom community to St. Louis. And they only take 95 people a year into that show. And you really get featured in that show. It was unbelievable how much art I sold. I was actually worried about running out of images, printed images. I easily sold 12 of my large frame prints for between $600 to $800 each at that show. And it's amazing. I haven't been able to get into it again because unless you win an award, you're not invited back again. That show, it's very unique for art shows. They actually pre-sell what they call art dollars. And in some years, they have as much as $1 million in art sales. And what they do is they give you art dollar money to the people who buy, and what you get back in return is VIP access to special events where the artists will give talks at the event. You'll get access to a Friday evening fancy dinner that they do, and they'll have talks and the committees. And then from 7 o'clock to 10 o'clock at night, all the artists, you'll have your booth set up with lights, and it's just for them to come and visit, and they won't leave before 10 o'clock. It's just amazing. And they're going around and they're trying to get to know the artists and see what's going on and, you know, what might their buying decisions be over the next 2 days. And you know you're doing something right when people come back and they're spending art dollars on your work, because they're people who, you know, it's really a compliment. The best show that I like around here in New York has been Gracie Square. They only take 100 artists, and it's all artists. There's no craft work at all. And the museum up in Connecticut, I just lost the name of it now. You know, they only take about 100 artists too. And I've been in that, and that's really an honor to go in there. You know, to get in that show, it's probably, you know, they'll tell you at the dinner that, you know, you're really recognized as one of the top artists in the, you know, Mid-Atlantic and New England to get into that show. And they're not bashful to pat you on the back for that one either. And you can tell by the way the clients come and speak to you. And, you know, I enjoy it. And it's helped me grow a lot as an artist to get that kind of feedback. And, you know, for me being in business and to actually feel confident to be able to, you know, a New Yorker will come up to you and say something like, how much is that? And I'll say $900. And I generally tell them, well, this work is pre-discounted. And they'll look at me like, okay, what's the deal with this? And pre-discounted means that I know their neighborhood. And if they saw this in the galleries in their neighborhood, this would be on sale for $1,200 to $1,500. And they know that, and they don't push back. And they often buy anywhere from one to three. I was tired one time in New York. It was like Sunday night, the show was ending, and somebody said, well, what will you do if I give you $900 cash? And I said, I'll pay your sales tax. And that was the only discount I'd given anybody in like 3 years for selling art. So composition, you know, being the scientist and studying this and try and break it down to what do I need to know to improve my craft and feel good about it. I like this definition that I found. It's the pleasant arrangement of elements within a frame which give the most powerful ability to attract the eye and to keep exploring it within the frame for as long as possible. And that's really what I was telling you and what I go for with my images. And I have quite a few people that have bought that and say, I don't know why I keep staring at this. I don't even know what it is. And I like that. And I like those kind of clients. Key points, I've already mentioned these. For me in making compositions is think like an artist and a painter, you know, break out. Don't just read what the camera manufacturers and printers are saying about. Think about different concepts of simplification. It can mean many different things, but it's really removing distracting elements. You know, it's like the picture of taking, you know, a family picture and there's a tree standing out of somebody's head. Get rid of the tree. You know, if you see dust spots, get rid of them. If you see edges of things in your image coming up against the sides of the print, just get rid of them. But for making compositions, I think if you learn how, what your way of thinking like an artist is, ideally, it should just feel natural to you. And this process should just, you know, it just happens. And then as you're in the field, you know, just balance out, you know, what's left. And that's what I do. And that's why I've adopted the photographic strategy that I have. I do like iconic places, but you know, for the iconic pictures that I often have liked and like, oh yeah, if I was there, I could make that too. It's not true. You know, Mark Munch, you know, has said, the light's never the same in the same place. And it's true. You can't, you know, reproduce. I think trying to reproduce other people's images is an important part of the learning process and iconic landscapes. You know, the one I showed you that I made back in 2010, that was important for me. You know, it gave me confidence that, yeah, I think I am past my lucky one out of 1,000. Now what can I do? And, you know, if I keep shooting iconic pictures, and I know it, because I had some when I first started selling at art fairs, they don't really sell. You can have great pictures of Yosemite, but for people who are really collectors, they know who the Yosemite photographers are. And, you know, they're prints cost as much as mine do. And if you're going to spend $800 for a print like that, you know, they're going to want to buy it from the guy who's famous. Yeah. And, you know, that's just the way it goes. And if you're at art shows that are very competitive, like the ones that I've been in, if you're just doing iconic pictures like that, you're not going to get in. Because they're not going to see you like an artist. in the way that they want their audience and people that they, you know, bring back. So, you know, that's what I've been learning and how I've been practicing. Here's another image that I tend to go towards the abstract and intimate landscapes. This one was, I did this one in Brigandine earlier this year, and it was a 90 second exposure. And you can see the histogram, it looks great to me, but you know, what was on the camera being neutral, I like the neutral because I can do anything I want with that image because I have lots of room on the left and the right to make creative edits, but it doesn't look so great on the back of my camera. If I had had it show up as a JPEG on the back of my camera, the histogram, I think, shows up the same as what you're seeing now on the raw image. But if I was trying to expose for something creatively, that JPEG, it's just too confusing by the time I come back from the field and I'm looking in my Lightroom catalog for my brain to sort through it. So it doesn't bother me have dull, boring pictures because my process, I know where the starting points are for what I do. And to the right is closer to where I've got, you can see the histogram, how it looks and how much that had been brightened up. But I still think there's a lot that could be simplified. You can see in this one here, I did simplify some of the pilings. I didn't like how it was touching the edge. Normally when I go for something like this, odd numbers of repetitive things work better. It didn't really bother me that it was six, but I said, you know, I think five would have been more interesting. So recently I started playing with five. And then I said, well, you know, I think three could be even more interesting. So what I did was I just, you know, started sketching out some edits. And what I did was I said, yeah, I'm just going to make it three. And I also isolated just one part of the sky because I said, you know, I like that part of the sky, but I think what I'm going to do is transform that part of the sky, flip it in the horizontal, and I'm going to use it to make the other half of the cloud and that sky be symmetrical. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a mask to it, a black mask. Then I'm going to blend that transformation into it and create it into this. And you know, and it's not that hard to do. It's harder to visualize this in your head as a creative thing to do. And, you know, whether it's a better image, I like it because it was challenging and I like the simplification in it here. And I went from this aspect ratio of a 2:3 to a 1:1. And you can also notice that the pilings, I thought the pilings, they should be, the end ones should be curving into me just a little bit more. So you can see, you know, I was able to do a transformation of the one on the right and bring it in. I applied my mask again. I just blended it in and you'd be amazed at how straightforward something like that can be. And that's what I did with it. There are a lot of compositional styles that people might use. I don't have any particular favorites. I just go by, you know, what's the first thing that caught my eye, and then what I do is I start building from it. What's here in nature that I find interesting and what could I do to make it stronger as an artist? And what can I do in the field? What would be the most important elements to start playing around with? And when I make images, you know, I want them to be considered good to my audience. And what I found that my audience responds to well is it's abstracts. And generally it needs to be, I find it needs to be more than the literal subject matter. And literal subject matter, you know, that's like the iconic scenes or doing documentary pictures. I mean, I think they're beautiful. I love that Oxbow Bend. It's probably, you know, an image that I'm incredibly proud of that I actually figured out how to make something like that. And it only took me a year to, to figure it out. It took me a month to optimize it. But, you know, it's a learning process and I like learning that. I like to offer viewers something that's unexpected. And that's the part about when I say that they'll look at it and they'll go, I don't know why I keep staring at this, but that's what I'm talking about. You know, it's my view, it's my vision. They're not gonna find it in another booth or online somewhere. And I'm really trying to capture the mood because I want as much of how I felt and what I was seeing in the image, you know, and on location to be in the image. And that's where I have to start thinking like an artist, because the cameras, you can just keep buying cameras all the time and you're never gonna get, unless it's, just a really, really lucky one out of 1,000 picture. And you might think you knew what you did. Maybe you did and you saw it, but that's another talk. So, you know, you've seen how, you know, I draw the eye in, and it's, you think of it like visual storytelling and exploring. And I like to design my images so that when I'm in the field exploring, I want to be able to put those kinds of things that I call as visual cues in, so that somebody who might be at an art show, if they look at it, they're going to explore it in maybe a different way, but I'm pretty sure there's going to be something in there that's going to draw them in. And I love to talk to them about that, of what they're feeling and seeing. And it's always important in any image, you can know about all these visual cues, but you also need to leave naturally feeling resting points in an image. And however you do that, you have to find a way, because the eye, when it looks at something, vision's a funny thing, you know, in 5 seconds, you might make 15 observations and your brain's going around putting together these, mosaics of patterns. And it doesn't really see the images, it's just patterns that it's sending to you. And these patterns, it's learned behavior. So if you kind of think of it like that, of how we think and see, you can start considering how you could use these things to make your strongest images. And who knows what you might discover. Here's one that I made last year when I was at Glacier National Park. I think anybody who read the newsletters and that Vince has put out, the one on the left is the bear grass at Glacier. You wouldn't know that the sky was washed out like that, but if you look at the histogram, you can see there's nothing blowing out on this image at all. And I can do pretty much anything I want to the right side of this image. What I did on this is that bear grass, I wanted those flowers, they were glowing because of the sunlight that was coming in, and I wanted to capture all the detail in those flowers of that glowing and make those things just glow. And I saw, when I was on that hillside there, a river of flowers just coming off the mountain. And I loved the juxtaposed positioning of the, you know, the dead trees. They were black, but you can see with a histogram, I can do whatever I want with those trees because I didn't lose any of the detail. I never leave anything in my images that's totally black. there's always a detail to be found in there, and I use that to create visual interest. So there's my river of flowers. And when I started editing it, something happened to me that I didn't anticipate. I envisioned this as going into a black and white, and I couldn't do it, and it was killing me. I was spending way too much time editing this thing. I got to the composition, you know, straightening the lines, getting the tree straight, you know, that took almost no time at all. But I could not get separation between those beautiful flower heads and the ground cover. They were literally indistinguishable from each other. All it was just monotone. It was horrible, absolutely horrible. So what I started doing was I started looking at putting filters across the image. And all of a sudden I discovered something where that if I put this kind of a bronze filter on top of the image, I all of a sudden got separation between the glowing flower heads and that really distracting ground cover. And I found a way to kind of get the ground cover to just sort of, you know, it was just background at that point. And I didn't really mind the color. I kind of liked it because I'd never really added a color to it. And I said, you know, it's not the most natural yellow color, but you know, how many people actually go to Glacier and would know? Because this was not on the beaten path. This was my knowing Gaia and knowing, you know, what the weather was. And I placed myself in a place where I could get that, you know, quiet moment and just, you know, really go deep in exploring this one. So, you know, here's what I saw as the artist. I love verticals. You can see my visual path in the yellow. And I thought there was more that I could do for this. And you can see at the bottom, I have the white arrows. And I said, wouldn't it be interesting if I started sweeping out by doing, going into Photoshop again and warping the picture a bit and spread out the base so that it would exaggerate the flowers a little bit, pointing in to the bottom of where the river flow was. And there's the black and white. You can see what I did with the flowers. Look at the energy that I got into this picture by putting more diagonal onto that bare grass. And I got the glow. And you know, I should have a few weeks ago when I was, you know, here, you know, I wish I had thought to just go back to black and white, but I kind of liked that bronze color. I'm not sure which one is going to settle in, is, you know, what I'm seeing is my strongest way of seeing, but you know, this is my process. That's what I do. I have no timeline. There's no deadline. I do this because I love doing it, and I can. Here's another image that I had. It's another abstract. This was up along the Swift River in the White Mountains. I absolutely love foliage reflections on water. The kind of rifts that you see, you know, this was 1/125th of a second. It was wind gusts. And what you have to do is get really low on the river, and it has to be a day where the sky is pure blue, no clouds, and you need to find river bends where the reflections are in deep, dark shadow. So I'm on Gaia again, and I'm looking for all those river bends, and the Swift River in the fall, it gets shallow, and it's not hard to find these places. And when I saw this, you know, I just feel like I'm an impressionist painter. And that was, the left is the original. I did have a bit of a problem with the being out of gamut on the left, but you know, it was hard to get the right wind gust. and you know, you're crouching and you got to use a variable neutral density filter, and sometimes a polarizer, you know, both of those to sometimes get the right exposure. And it's, and I'm in my fishing waders, I'm on my knees in the river, and I slipped up, you know, that was the best one of the series. But you know, you can see on the right where I landed with this. And, you know, and then, you know, here's another of, you know, where I said I'd landed, that's on the left. It, you know, it looks like I'm a little out of gamut on that. There's another one on the right that I compressed it. I've been playing around with 1:1 aspect ratios lately. But here's what I saw as an artist with that image. I saw triangles, and I saw radiating triangles coming from that upper left corner down into the rest of it. And the white circles, they were just patches of beautiful color. I didn't care what they were, if you could distinguish anything about them, but I knew that those diagonal lines were really powerful. And when you get three of something, or odd numbers, I had three triangles, I had five circles, I knew I was onto something. And you know, you experiment, and that's what I did. And I have a whole series of these that I've done, and people have responded to these very well. These have been very good sellers for my work, and I get a lot of people. It just stops them in their tracks.
Excuse me, Peter.
Yes.
Time for confession.
Okay.
When you were there, your mind told you this was your composition. Did you
Yes.
honestly see in through your viewfinder or with your eye three triangles and five circles, or did you see, oh, this is a good shot from your artistic point of view, and when you put it on the monitor, then you found your circles and your triangles, which confirmed that you had found a good image?
Yes, that's exactly correct. And I use these drawing tools as a way to try and teach how to pre-visualize these things. Without any doubt, what I saw in the field and what drew me in, I saw those two lines from the birch trees coming down, and that division, and knowing that that had a focal point that was a radius. Whenever you get something that's a radius like that, keep exploring it, because those can be very, very powerful things. I have one abstract that I've done from Longwood Gardens of the tulip gardens that is just like this composition in how it was put together. But instead of waiting for wind gusts to put something interesting across the surface there, I did intentional camera motion. And there, it's just illustrative. I definitely saw all the patches. When I go out and I'm looking at something like this, I really get into a zone of letting my mind wander with these things, and I go abstract. And there's something about the way I think and process information that I don't do myself a justice when I'm attracted to really complex landscapes and designs. It'd be a lot easier if I just did the brigantine thing straight up, but that's not how my mind always works. I'm attracted to the complex, and then all of a sudden finding something that unifies it. So what you're seeing here is a description of, you know, how I unified it. Does that help, Vince?
Yeah, I think what you said was the white lines drew you in, and then your artistic vision subsequently demonstrated the characters of the picture that made it good.
Yeah, that's exactly correct. What I was drawn to, it was all about the colors and the patches.
Yes.
But the colors and the patches by themselves, I always like, you know, you have to have some kind of a reference point, even in an abstract. You have to put something that's, you know, that can unify it or simplify the image so that it gives the eye a rest. And that's what the birch trees provided for me. It gave me something that, you know, don't try to study all the detail in those colorful patches. You know, maybe I could have just done the patches, and if I filled them out across the entire frame, I bet you those would be interesting. And they might not be as complex as this composition. And I'll probably go back and do that again, you know, someplace else or there again. But there's nothing like the White Mountains on the Swift River, where you can find so many different colors just by moving over, you know, 100 feet on the stream, on the same river bend. It's amazing. And, you know, you can just, you know, pretend to be an impressionist painter. And it's just the way my mind works. And I liked it. And this kind of design, it's been really good for me at art shows. And it makes me happy making something like that. Whether I explain it so that somebody can go out and try and make it themselves, go out and try it, see what you find. You know, start exploring and seeing what catches your eye. I found that you won't see this kind of reflection if you stand up too high. You really gotta, and the Swift River, because in the fall, it's really shallow. There are a lot of spots where you can walk in and it's not deep. If it was springtime, I've been to spots where people have fallen in and they've drowned because it's so rough. This is one of these corners. It's just not accessible except in low water times. And it's easily across about a 2.5 mile stretch of the Swift River that you can find all kinds of compositions. You can even go further north, you know, up to the ski areas, even above Mount Washington, and you'll find lakes up there where you don't have to look for abstracts like this. You can find, you know, really straightforward reflections of trees along the lakeside. And they're beautiful and they're interesting. And they're, you know, I look at those as really intimate, you know, intimate landscapes. And there's more that you can orientate. These are hard to design. And it's just, you know.
Peter, I have a question.
Yeah.
I'm looking at that picture, and do you make a print? And then do you just go and color the lines on it? Or just, how do you do that?
Oh, this. So what I did, you know, my print was made from the image you see on the right.
Right.
Here. What this is in PowerPoint. I just, you can draw lines on it. And this morning, I was trying to think of a way that I could explain what thinking like an artist might be. And I remembered seeing a book with Ian Plant about visual flow. And I went, oh yeah, he's had some great descriptions and graphics. And I pulled out my Wacom tablet, and I started trying to draw the lines, and I went, oh my God. You know, his lines, he didn't draw those. He chose graphical figures. And I said, I don't have time to do that. I just need something that's quick and dirty. And what I did was I just got rid of the Wacom because I couldn't draw a straight line. It was too humid this morning and my hand kept sticking to the where I was putting my wrist down. So I just used my little trackpad and I went and drew as slowly as I could to write straight lines, and I changed the colors to make it so that something would stand out.
Okay, thank you.
I'm sorry if people thought that these lines were part of the image. No, those were just, that was a way to help me describe what I was trying to design in the field for my camera. So here, when I was looking at the bear grass, because I don't see things like I did 10 years ago as flowers and mountains, I see everything as shapes. I see circles, I see lines, I see patterns and textures. This is me just, you know, think I didn't draw patterns in and everything, because that just would have been too embarrassing to try and put, draw those. I had enough troubles drawing in the arrows, and that was about as straight a line as I could draw. So obviously you have to connect with your subject in order to get a picture, because if you don't feel something from the scene, your audience isn't either. So, you know, do you feel at peace? You know, for me, there's a kind of a tranquility of being out in nature. For me, I just love that feeling. And you know, I like analyzing things, and the camera, it just, I get to do both. And I like to be remote and, you know, have time to myself. And you know, it's kind of a way that I, you know, sort of reset myself and, you know, deal with, you know, stress. I like to be in awe of things that I'm seeing and capture that. So wherever I go, I do a lot of homework ahead of time of what's, you know, geologic features are there. I'll know what kind of, you know, how the mountains got there, anything that's unique about them. And, you know, and that's what I, you know, it's kind of a thing of respect of nature. And I'm just in awe of wild places and how, you know, we've been fortunate that some of these places have really been preserved. You know, last year when I was in Glacier, and then I went up to Jasper for 4 weeks. And there I was in the ice fields, and oh my God, I'm looking at 20,000 year old ice fields, and I can't wait to share those abstracts with you. It's pretty cool. So I connect with it because I know what's special about the geography and the weather and what happened to get it to be what it is, and just in awe of people who preserve this kind of thing, because it would be so easy to put up hotels in some of these places or to sell tickets to go see this kind of stuff and not trample over it. And use that energy, you know, as a springboard to express yourself. I have no problem if I'm out, that if I don't make an image, I don't feel like I missed anything. I had a good day because I know where I'm going. And I know why I'm there, and making an image is just the icing on the cake. And then getting to play with it when I come home, and see, you know, what else I can do with it. That's what I do. Here's another example of an image that I made. This one was from Colorado in the fall. It was outside of Telluride. Image on the left. It looks really flat and everything, you know why, but what you don't know is that it was, you know, I was driving with my wife, and, you know, she was driving, I'm looking out the window, and I said, stop, and she said, why do you want to stop here? And there was this, it's because it was the fog was coming in, there was a rainy mist, and she said, what are you going to shoot? And I said, I'll explain it to you later, but there was about 200 feet away, the fog was going through these aspens. And the picture on the right, which is close to what the print is that I made, you could see the blue in the side there. And there was actually a little bit of skylight that was coming in. That blue was the natural light coming in from the sky into this really, really soft, you know, I'm shooting white on white, you know, fog on birch, and look at the detail that I was able to preserve. not only was it technically challenging, but I knew what I could do with something like this as a print. And, you know, so here was the artist in me. You know, this is what I'm doing compositionally. I loved the verticals, lines of all of that. And, you know, so there's the pattern of trees. And then I liked this brown patch of grass that was going on. It was like a path. So here I am kind of, you know, here's a path. If I went up close to this, I'd walk into the woods that way. And I found that really interesting. And I knew how to set this up so that, you know, if you ever have something as busy as this, you know, here I am, you know, why couldn't I just find simpler images while I'm in the field? You can really get hurt trying to make images like this. This has probably been my best selling image. I think I only have one left of this now in the edition. And a lot of people, they see this and it's a 5-minute impulse buy for people that connect with this one. Here's something that I did just recently playing with it. You know, I told you I really liked the light that was coming in. You know, it was like 10 minutes away from sunset, and somehow or other there was just a little bit of light, skylight, that was coming in, and that was the blue from the sky that was being captured on the aspen trees. You know, this is me connecting to the scene. You know, I'm aware of so many things that are happening around me geographically, atmospherically. And I said, you know, it would really be nice if I had a straight line on the bottom of these trees, you know, and that's what I did. I went in and I transformed this image. I just made it straight across the bottom and I cropped it a little bit. You can see where the curve starts, you know, of the path. I just curved it out there. And you can see when you come to this one, you know, using the warping, there's no evidence that, you know, I've been there. You won't find it. You know, I didn't do anything that was really unnatural, but you can see I changed it quite a bit.
Peter, can you describe what you mean by warping for those who aren't familiar?
So what happens is that, you know, it's easy to crop an image. You know, in Lightroom or any program, you know, you can, you know, if you shoot like a full frame, it's a 2-to-3 aspect ratio of something, you know, it's natural size. It might be like 20 inches by 30 inches. If you make a 1-to-1 aspect ratio, it's a 1-to-1. But, you know, sometimes if you have an aspect ratio, like even in this image here, I could have done a transformation of this whole thing. And what I mean is that I select the entire image and I can stretch the image selectively. And warping is one of the probably 12 different ways that you can transform an image. You can transform it by, I just want to change the vertical of this image, or I just want to change the horizontal. In this case, what I want to do is I want an anchor point that if I click on it, I can, depending on how much I move the anchor in the location that I pick, everything will move in that particular relationship. You have to do it by feel. You put the anchor point down and then you just, you know, you just experiment a little bit. And once you're familiar with that particular tool, I mean, look at how much I did to this. You know, even if you look at this original image, you can see from the bottom, say you go in to the bottom, that second arrow in from the bottom, you know, look at how far up that tree is from the edge of the image where the grass is at the bottom. Look where it is now. I put it all the same distance away. The edge, you know, the distance between the edge of the image and the bottom of the trees, look what I did. I did it across the entire image, 5 minutes with warping, because I'm familiar with the tool and it's one that I like to use a lot. It was the same tool that I used on the bear grass to just stretch out the base a little bit to give it, you know, to enhance the diagonal lines to create more energy, because I wanted to see the flowers look more like flowing water opening up to a wider spot in the river. And the bottom of that composition that I'm making, it was flowing into the wider part of that river. That's what I mean by, you know, visualizing that in the field. I knew I was going to do that when I was in the field. It was just a matter of time before I got to it and, you know, made the quiet time, took the time to do it. It's not easy. You have to put yourself in the right mindset. And when I do that and I'm ready to do it, you know, I can make it look easy, but, you know, I'm somebody who, you know, as a scientist, like one of my skills is working in R&D and developing products from new to the world and putting them out in the market. I just have this ability to see really complex things and make them simple. Like, could you imagine the technology that I was working on? It was PCR technology. Nobody had ever turned it into a kit. The technology, it took that when it was first invented and we paid the $300 million for the exclusive license to own PCR technology when I was at Hoffman LaRoche, it took 2 days to take something where you could extract the nucleic acid and then amplify it enough to make enough copies of that you could analyze it by conventional methods of chromatography or whatever you'd want to do. I was on the team that within 2 years, we took that from nothing and turned it into a 1.5 hour kit that you could turn it into a handful of reagents. And from start to finish, you were done. And you would be able to diagnose like whether or not a patient, what their HIV viral load was. I was so fortunate. I was in on the ground floor. You know, we've had coronavirus. The people that I was working with, we were on that team collaborating on fast tracking for approval of that HIV viral load with Anthony Fauci as one of the people that was reviewing our data for FDA submission, as well as Hazeltine, as somebody that we worked with. So if I was still there at Roche, I would have been on the team for doing the coronavirus. So that's how my head works. I can take really complex things and make them simple.
And so that's in reference to this, Peter, just to go through the chat questions. This is a Photoshop technique. And in summary, you're pinching, pulling, stretching, shrinking selectively pieces of the image, right?
Let's see, 7:30. Yeah, we've been at this for an hour and a half now. Do you want me to jump ahead to that area of where I'll start discussing, you know, how to add creative effects so we can wrap up?
Yes, I think that sounds good.
Okay, great. Thanks for moving us along here. You know, you kind of get the idea of, you know, what I've done. Depth perception is a really tricky thing. You know, there are no built-in QC factors that help you translate from 3D to even near equivalent two-dimensional. But if you want pictures with depth, you have to be thinking about this. And, you know, here's an example of, you know, depth that I've added in to things. So here's starting to get into an example of a famous painting of how distance, tone, color, and texture, just these simple things. Number one is the the most contrasty thing. When this number two is the second most, number three is the third, and you can see, you know, as contrast decreases, the sense of depth increases. This is what you have to do. Our cameras, they ruin what we see in our mind's eye. You have to be able to figure out how to bring that depth in. And it's illusion. Here's an simple example of saturation. Fall off in black colors. You know, there you go. Here's where I'm getting into some of the things that I do for the visual cues and printing and editing adjustments. It's all about tonal relationships. I've gotten to a point, especially towards printing, of just seeing photographs as a collection of tones, and we relate tones to each other and to bring in the sense of depth to things. When people give me their images to print, I always do a strip of test prints for people where, you know, I'll print something, one along the bottom of one of my rolls of paper. And so my rolls are 24 inches wide, and I'll usually do something where I'll have four or five that'll fit across the bottom, and I'll make them that they might be 7 inches on, you know, on the short side, maybe 5.5, depending on how many I need. And I'll put their original image. And then I do these things that I just label them as Adobe Camera 1, Adobe Camera 2, you know, ACR 1, ACR 2, ACR 3. And they're little tonal adjustments that I do to put in the visual cues. If somebody was looking over my shoulder, they might say you didn't do anything, but this is what I'm doing. I'm putting myself in their shoes. I'm not changing their image, but I'm creating the feel of their image, what's on the computer screen, onto print. And, you know, it's understanding very, very subtle tonal relationships and adding them back on. And the things that I'm adding to these things, it's mostly just light contrast and color saturation. These are the most important things. Only three things that I'm working on. And this is how simple it is, how I've broken it down. Just light contrast, color saturation. More of that brings more attention. Less of it is less attention. So when I'm out in the field, this is exactly how I'm thinking. Those are your things. Light is your number one thing. And contrast, well, that's where the histogram becomes really important, because if you blow out your histogram and go out of gamut, you're not going to have fine control over your lights and darks, and you've just lost a very important element of bringing depth to your images. So this is how I think and what I use. And I have over 50 clients now that come to me for printing, some of them more often than others. But when they see what I'm doing, when you see the print in real life, they're just blown away by it. And they go, I've never seen that. And unless you pay somebody to do the kind of test printing that I do. And honestly, I taught myself this, you know, there was my challenge, and 11 years ago, or 10 years ago, go sell art. And sometimes when I had an image, I'd go through half a roll of paper, and I'd spend 8 hours on that, and I still wasn't happy with the print. And I kept asking myself, what do I need to know to get this to come out right? And I said, well, I think my pictures, this seems to be it, because I can get there, you know, with with some of these. And, you know, I'd had a couple of people who coached me on editing, you know, 11 or so years ago, that made a huge change to me, you know. And once I learned how they thought, that's all I cared about. I just asked them, I just care about how you think. I don't care about your camera or anything else. What do you do and feel when you drop yourself into some of these locations? And this is basically what I learned. You know, if I putting together all the notes of my interviews of these people, this is what I learned. And the last year, I got very frustrated with changes in editing processes. And I had a number of things that I was doing. I had some presets that I was doing in Lightroom and all these other programs that were coming out. And all of a sudden, it's like my image processing, it started to really degrade. And I felt like it was looking like everybody else's. And it hit me over the head. Presets are just using canned optimizations from some other people's vision, and they're selling them to me. And they're selling them to me when I look at the advertising and I go on YouTube as though, hey, look what you can do. You know, I've already done all the hard, you know, the heavy lifting here, and just use my presets and you can get the same effects on your images. And when the Nick tools, that was like my really big eye opener when it didn't work on my computer anymore. I realized how dependent I'd become on presets, and I had to figure out, how do I get myself, where am I in my photography and my images, all the way from beginning through editing to the printing. And what I found is that, you know, Lightroom is a beautiful catalog. I could do all the things that I told you about in Lightroom these days because it's really gotten sophisticated and it can do all of this stuff. I could do 90-95% of it all there. But the problem is, if I ever want to go back to anything, just try going in the history and getting lost in all of that stuff. And, you know, it's, if I just go into Photoshop, you know, just bring it into Photoshop and start looking at the curves, I only have to use three types of curves in Photo Shelter, and I put black masks on them and I just paint in curves, hue, saturation, and selective color. Curves is the most amazing tool that you can use. And if you use it in a mask that you just paint either a black or a white brush, that, you know, you go over the whole image and, you know, it looked like a global adjustment that you make and you go, oh, that's too dark or that's too bright. But when you put the black mask on, all of a sudden nothing comes through with that. And what you do is you just paint with a white brush what you want to come back in. So if you want to put a vignette in, you darken the whole thing with your curves adjustment. You put the black mask in, then you get a brush, and then you just play around with, you know, have it be a soft brush. Don't have it be too strong in its opacity. And you just paint the vignette in and make the brush really big. And all of a sudden you just start seeing things that, wow, you know, that's easier. And I have way more control than I ever had with any preset or trying to use like the vignette tool in any of these canned programs, you know, like even Lightroom. You know, there's really only one way, you know, that the vignette works down at the bottom. And it's great. You know, I would say probably over 50-60% of the images, just that vignette, and you know, works fine. But if you start getting into the layers of this and just make more layers, you know, I might be working on just one section of an image. I might do six layers of curves on different parts of the image, and yeah, and I'll I just play with it. Sometimes it's a black brush, sometimes it's a white. And I always have to keep envisioning, you know, what the final image is. And I don't go to these adding impact to the image first. You know, it's really important. In Lightroom, you go in the top of your menus there. You can see where all the global adjustments are. And the first thing I do is I go to see the histogram. I go to see what the color is. I go to check to see what my color space is. I want to make sure I have, I'm working in the biggest color space, like Adobe Pro Photo, because I want it to be a 16-bit depth file, because if I don't, here's what it looks like to me as somebody who does fine, art, image and print optimization. My file will offer me about 16 trillion options of how I can control light, contrast, and color saturation. If I used the JPEG 8-bit file that comes out of the camera as it looks on the back of my camera on the display, I only have about 10 million options, maybe 50 million options of how I can make meaningful adjustments, you know? So it's 16, we're talking 5-6 orders of magnitude more control of your work. That's huge. So that's what it means to somebody like me to go raw. If somebody gives me an Adobe, RGB, file instead of the Pro Photo, I know the difference, but I never change anybody's color space because there's still, if there's still 16-bit, we can do anything we want with that image that you envision of what you're trying to communicate. If they go into a JPEG, unless that image is perfect, really perfect, not out of gamut. And as you can see, to have an image that you might really think is perfect, you can see the kind of creative exposures that I do. They look horrible on the back of the camera. But I know from the histogram, because I've studied the histograms and I know what I can control. And these are the things that I control when I edit. And I can make those adjustments very quickly. But I can't do them quickly. Because common issues that, I didn't used to be able to do them quickly, because all of us, when we're first starting to edit images and do printing, we learn things and we don't always see what's on the computer screen on your printer paper. And there are a couple of reasons. Calibration is one of them, but it's, and that's a pretty obvious one right there. But some things is that if you're not aware of how your eyes and brain adapt to the environment and correct your vision for things the way it thinks you expect those patterns to appear, and not how they might really be appearing to the camera, computer, and printer on your devices, you can't see it. And here's a perfect example of it. Somebody can give me an image and they optimized it, maybe it's in Gamma or not, but if it has a really bright yellow cast on it, I know immediately that they had a incandescent light bulb on next to their computer monitor. They were probably working at nighttime and there was a yellow cast on their computer monitor and their brain didn't let them see that. It automatically corrected that stuff over the time you were viewing it. When you come back to that image in the morning or the next day and you see it, it's like, where'd that yellow come from? That wasn't there yesterday. What happened to my image? This is why. And it's one of the things that confounds people as they're trying to learn photography and get control over all of their processes. So my workspace here, I have 4,700 Kelvin working lights. That's perfect neutral, you know, colored daylight. My entire room is daylight. It's the same no matter what time it is. And even my windows, you know, if the light's right, I can turn the lights off in my room. And I know when the temperature's like 5,000 Kelvin in my room, and I just let the natural light come in from the room, and it appears just like the artificial light does that I'm working in. So this is one of the things that often confounds people, and they get inconsistencies, and they may or may not be aware of these things. If they're aware of the light bulb problem, the calibration is one that there's a lot of resistance of people to do it, or they may go, boy, the device like I'm using, it's almost $300. And it's like, oh, I'm just an amateur. I'm not going to spend $300 for that display model. I'm going to buy the $100 one. Or they might see something on sale. And, you know, I know the differences of the colorimeters that are going on. And this one, it sets a really high standard for all of them. And if I get an image from somebody else, you know, I can tell in 30 to 60 seconds whether somebody has a calibrated monitor, whether it's too bright or too dark, and I can take a pretty good stab at whether or not you have a destructive or non-destructive workflow and whether or not you have a color cast in your room, just because I've seen enough and I've learned it and I know how to correct for it. And that's one of the things I, you know, that, you know, Henry came to me like 4 years ago, and you know how picky Henry is. And he said, and he came to visit me and he brought a bunch of images and he said, you know, his printer broke and he can't make big ones and he didn't want to spend the money to, you know, buy a big one. And he said, can you do my printing? And we sat for a few hours and I did the prints and he said, you know, I don't want anybody else to print my images. You're my printer. And and he didn't care if I told anybody. I didn't. I was his ghost printer. I've been his ghost printer for about 3 years and he knows what I've been doing.
Peter, there we go. Oh, you're back.
I figured it out.
Yeah, okay.
You guys ready to wrap up?
Peter, maybe we can come to a gallery view, stop screen sharing. Did you have anything else that you had to, that we
already No, that's, that's really my story.
Okay.
I had some things of some optical illusions, but we're clearly out of time.
Yeah, I think we are.
Yeah.
And I think we should... bring everyone back in, those who are with us still. And one question that was asked earlier was, do you teach printing at your place for like a workshop?
Actually, last year I did a printing workshop at the Princeton Photo Club. And it was a 3-hour workshop. And I really enjoyed that. And the reviews that came back from that were really high, and people enjoyed that a lot.
And we can look at that. How about at your place?
At my place, you know, with this whole COVID situation, I don't really know how to do that well, but I think I would be open to trying a Zoom workshop. And because I have my printer here and I am able to connect my camera to the computer. I can zoom in and out, and it's unbelievable how sharp the images are and the autofocus. I can go from the front of the room to the back of the room, and I can show different kinds of papers, and I have test papers that I can show the effect, and I can show examples.
Yeah, the person who asked the question is not with us right now, but I'll pass that on. Perhaps they could get in touch with you and
sure.
individual Zooms. Okay. Folks who are here, questions for Peter? Peter, how important is it when you're doing your vision of your setup to be using a tripod? Can you set up your whole line flow and visual cues without a tripod?
I can, but very often I have long exposures. I was in a workshop out at Yosemite, and I can be ready in 40 seconds with a camera bag on my back, and I can make an image, and I can do a pano all within less than 2 minutes. Once I take the, I'm like 40 seconds, I'm set up, I can have the image done in 2 minutes, and I'll have all the creative exposures, I'll be perfectly leveled, and if I saw it, I can capture it. Okay. And that's the cool thing. I don't live in the world anymore of the lucky 1 in 1,000. I know why images work, and I designed them there, and I can see it, and I think I just enjoy doing it so much.
Another question, do you separate your metering from your focus so you can concentrate more in your composition?
Absolutely. You have to, I have to do it that way. And on the Canon 5DSR that I used to use, I reprogrammed so that the shutter only did exposure, and the focus was something that I used with my thumb toggle. So I would put that in my histogram, was always, I could tell right away what the histogram would be when I pushed the shutter and I got the exposure. I would be able to evaluate in real time where the histogram was going based on where the, that focus spot was. So I would make those decisions there. And that's how I was able to expose for the correct creative image. And then I would see it neutral on my camera. And that was, gave me security of being able to control my image from concept to print.
Can you put your contact information in the chat to everyone?
Oh, sure. It's just peterhewitt.com.
Reach out to you to talk about some Zoom sessions and things like that.
Sure. And you know, once we get going, I'd love to do it in person, but it's once you get going, the one at Princeton, it was 3 hours that we had done, and everybody had I think they all paid $75 each for it, and I still get feedback from that. Dave Burwell, he said the feedback was so strong from that workshop that he invited me to do a workshop with him later this year, and that we haven't discussed what our topics might be yet, but he wanted to collaborate on something like that. So I don't know what we might do together, but I kind of like seeing creatively, and he does a lot of editing in Lightroom and Photoshop. So that might be a really interesting hybrid for the two of us to go down. And yeah, some folks can look up like that.
Maybe a Saturday once we open. But that's not going to be before the end of the year.
Yeah.
All right.
I think in a larger space, it's really about airflow and distance.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what we need. And I can't really do that this way.
Anyone else want to throw anything out there? Well, Peter, that was great.
I got just one question there, Peter.
Yeah.
Now, I was just wondering, do you have almost like a newsletter or something like that? Did you put out like
I don't.
A weekly or a monthly topic or something?
No, I I started that several years ago when I first doing art shows, but I found it really unsatisfactory. People, I had a really long list, but for customers like that, sometimes I get these messages back just a month later. Where'd you get this email? And, how dare you send me this unsolicited? And, and they wrote their name on a pad of paper and they said, I want to stay in touch with you. And they even bought work from me. So I didn't find it very rewarding to do that. And it was mostly other photographers that were contacting me and they wanted to learn what I was doing, but I didn't have enough skills at that time to really feel as though I could contribute anything of, having, enough experience to boil it down for them. And, over the last 2 years, especially with printing, I know in less than a minute how to help you. And, I put together exhibitions for people, and I offer, I have my prices on my website for the printing that I do, and I like to help other artists out, and I pass on to them the wholesale pricing that I'm able to get, because I sell enough that I have a framer who picks up the prints from my house, and he brings them back framed, and he goes through a whole virtual framing process with me, and artists, I coach them on to, if you really want to sell, I'll explain to them how this image might be undervalued.
Peter, the contact, is it Peter at Peter Hewitt? Is that the one I should?
Peter at PeterHewitt.com.
Okay, there you go.
And there's my email. And then you'll see I have all of my services that I offer and all my prices.
Well, thank you so much.
Thanks. Yeah, sorry to have run over.
That was great, Peter.
No problem.
I'm glad you liked it.
A lot of information. Maybe we'll need to work on the Photoshop talk at some time as well, I think.
Yeah, I think that's a talk by itself.
Yes, definitely.
I went a little heavy on the details because I know your group after meeting you last month and knowing you and the kinds of questions you ask. I thought, I'd rather go off the deep end of the pool than come up short.
Yes, you did a great job.
Thank you.
Peter joined our group after he was at one of our meetings, so that's really cool. So thanks, everyone. And all our guests, Mikey, see ya.
All right.
Thank you very
much. Thanks, folks.
See you guys later. And if you have any questions, please, you can just email me, direct me, or call me. My mobile number's there, and I'm happy to chat and would love to help you. Especially if you're going to place orders for printing and framing.
I'll add your cell real quickly into the chat box there.
Excellent.
Since you made reference to it.
Good show, everyone. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Yep,
Thank you very much.
The phone number's in the chat box. Thanks, everyone. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.